We have talked about different types of documents, about how you discover the lives of women in the past. We've seen women who are involved in legal proceedings in the early 20th century. We have some firsthand documentation about how wealthy women presented their reform efforts and also how they responded to those appeals. But it's really, once you get to the mid 20th century, when you begin to be able to really hear women's voices, women speaking for themselves, more frequently. And for archives, one of the really major breakthroughs of the 20th century is the creation of oral history archives. And oral history was actually founded here at Columbia by historian and history professor Alan Nevins. Columbia has one of the largest oral history collections in the country. And one of the treasures of that collection is Frances Perkins's oral history. So Frances Perkins is not an everyday woman, and it's true that, your average person would not be asked to do an interview with the Columbia Oral History Office. But nevertheless, this opportunity to speak at great length about her own life in a less formal way than writing a memoir or an autobiography was something that was really new, and historians have found it to be a really important means of doing their research.
And more and more important, I think, as time goes on, more and more important because there are relatively fewer written sources as we all resort to email and various other disposable, if you like, sources. But the thing about oral history that makes it so wonderful is that it is possible to get on record not only important people or significant people like Frances Perkins, but also less important people who happen to have experienced. We've just done here an oral history of the Guantanamo Bay prisoners. The lawyers and so on, people who've been involved in them. There have been oral histories of 9/11, of the people who experienced the collapse of those towers. So that in the future, historians will have a much wider range of experiences to draw on. In the case of Frances Perkins and the many sort of relatively well-known people like her who were thought worthy of actually capturing or setting down their own experiences, the document is enormously valuable, not so much for their precise description of events, because we all know that memory can not only be faulty, but is often shaped by events that follow after the event being recorded, but for the feeling tone, if you like, for the ways in which it articulates an experience. So you can find in an oral history the way a woman experienced a man's approach to her. Mm-hmm. Or here, for example, in this particular oral history of Frances Perkins, we have just a very short segment in where she describes what people called her when she became the first Secretary of Labor. She was the first female cabinet secretary in the country. Mm-hmm. And people didn't want to call her Madam Secretary. They didn't want to call her Secretary of Labor. That seemed too official for a lowly woman of any kind. And so they invented all kinds of other things to call her, until at last they came up with Madam Secretary as the compromise. Yeah. But they wouldn't call her anything else. But how she felt about that. You know, she says at one point they would stick in the madam first. They felt there must be some way by which they must recognize and describe femaleness in this creature and not refer to me as the Secretary of Labor, which of course they should have. Well, there's a huge, you know, emotional content behind that statement. How others felt about her, how she felt about herself, what she thought she had earned by this title, and how this, later she goes on to say how this affected her and the way people related to her. So, you know, oral histories, they're not valuable for the same thing mm-hmm. as the document is valuable for. But they're enormously illuminating about aspects of history that many of us writing have never had access to before.
Right, and they're also one of the main ways that archives are working now to redress this history of bias in collecting, and the attempt to collect oral histories with as many everyday people as possible. People from communities that don't have large archives of historical documents and haven't been able to preserve the records of lives going back several generations, oral histories become the primary means of capturing their stories. So as we talked about a tradition of bias in historical archives, this is a tradition that people are actively working to change now as we move forward, and oral histories is one of the main ways to do that.
As I think are many of the new techniques, quantification techniques, for example, in which we now count census records in different kinds of ways, in which we interpret questions about who's a member of the household in ways that are much more subtle than we did even 50 years ago. So I think women historians, or the historians of women, are in good shape. They'll find what they need to write the histories that come up in the future.